Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Fatal Glow by Valerie Wilson Wesley, narrated by Diana Blue. Chapter 1. There was no whiff of nutmeg, the usual warning that death is heading my way. No signs from the gift, that unreliable second sight that graces, and I use the word loosely, the women in my mother's family. No disturbing colors or sounds. I only heard my late husband's voice quoting, oddly enough, those well-known lines from Macbeth. By the pricking of my thumbs, something wicked this way comes. Daryl's voice usually comes at the end of a dream when I'm going through a rough spot or missing him more than usual. So, why this morning? I glanced up from my laptop as two men in suits that cost more than my monthly mortgage strolled past my cubicle into Tanya Risco's office. The younger was wickedly handsome. The older just looked wicked. His skin had a yellowish cast to it. A problem for a dark brown-skinned man, and although he was built like an aging prizefighter, the ring had definitely won the last round. Risco Realty, where I work, is a cut-rate real estate firm. Tanya, the owner and my boss, inherited the business from a vicious man brutally murdered in the room where the two gentlemen were headed.
"Wonder what that's about,"
muttered Vinton Laverne, who worked in the cubicle next to mine. Our workspaces were narrow and separated by low plastic boundaries, making it easy to keep your eye on what folks were doing and poke your nose where it wasn't meant to go. Something at which Vinton, a thin, dapper man, solemn as an owl, was adept. He also had a tart, endearing sense of humor that could turn bitter on a dime. When I first joined Risco Realty, he'd carried a gloomy gray glimmer that finally disappeared. He was happier now. Everything about him had changed, including the glimmer. Glimmers are something only I can see when certain people enter my space. A gift from the gift, you might say. They can be as hazy as a shadow, or as bright as a colorful aura. They often give a hint of what to expect from a stranger, or a clue into who that person really is. Yet, they can change for better or worse, depending upon what life has served up. My Aunt Phoenix, an expert on glimmers, charms, spells, and all things weird and extrasensory, said that we who see glimmers give them our own interpretation. So, it's not only what you get from a person, but who you think that person truly is, which complicates everything. Yet, seeing glimmers, coupled with the ability to sense, hear, and smell things other folks can't, is what makes me unique, along with a silver streak of hair that occasionally appears on the left side of my head.
If you want my guess, I'd say there's something going on between one of them and our little Tanya. Maybe both of them?
Said Vinton with a naughty wink that brought my attention back to him. Vinton, Tanya Risco, Harley Wilde, and Luella Jefferson had all become family to me now. When I began working at Risco Realty more than a year ago, there were 8 of us. Now, we were down to 5. Terrible things had happened to us in the past, and we'd healed together, just as family does. Luella was our youngest member. She had a sweet baby face with rosebud lips, wide, expressive eyes, and skin as smooth and dark as bittersweet chocolate. She'd gone through rough times, and they'd toughened her up, but there was still a gentleness about her. The first time I saw her, I was taken aback by her glimmer. That was such a shocking shade of violet, it made me want to cry. Things were better now. She still fought demons, one that would haunt her for the rest of her life. But she was trying to do the best she could to make a way for herself in real estate. Risco Realty was a new beginning for her, as it once had been for me. Usually, she had an easy smile that popped whenever she lifted her head, but the sight of these two men had wiped it off. Something had shaken her to the core. "Everything okay?" I asked. Luella stared straight ahead, her gaze following the men as they headed into Tanya's office. Then, her eyes dropped down to the laptop on her desk. Were they part of her past? I knew Luella hid parts of herself that she considered shameful and tucked away, trying to forget. Her old glimmer swept over her, then disappeared in nearly the same instant. And that worried me. Vinton couldn't see what I saw, but knew that something was wrong.
"Do you know these two guys, baby doll? Did they do something to hurt you?"
he asked, his voice protective and concerned. When he liked you, Vinton gave you a nickname. Mine was Sunshine, Luella's baby doll. She shook her head, avoiding his eyes.
"Then why won't you look at me?"
She glanced at him, then answered his question, her voice close to a whisper.
"Yeah, I know them both. Red says the old one stole his daddy's land and won't give it back. I know the young one from back in the day. Red knows him from those days, too."
Red was Luella's fiancé and the father of Erica, her 8-year-old daughter. He was part of her past and now her future. Although I hadn't met him yet, she claimed he had come back into her life to redeem them both. I wasn't so sure.
"Luella,
that can't be true. Charlie Risco stole Red's daddy's land," I said, stating something that we all knew now. As I spoke, I touched the talisman I wore around my neck. It's a blue lace agate on a leather string that once belonged to Rosemary, my mother, and was given to me last year by Celestine, my other gifted aunt. The mere mention of Charlie Risco's name called for serious spiritual protection.
"I know," Luella said, avoiding my eyes, "but Red doesn't feel that way. He feels different."
The vroom of a motorcycle caught my attention before I had a chance to ask just what that difference was, and my friend, late as usual, Harley Wild, bounced into the office, with a spring in his step and carrying the late morning latte grande he never failed to bring me. Settling down in his cubicle, he pulled the lid off his coffee, blew on it, and sipped loudly. Harley was younger than me by nearly 2 decades. We weren't related by blood, but had become as close as kin, connecting us in ways that surprised us both. He tried to maintain a gangsta swagger, but it concealed a joyful spirit, caring nature, and quick grin that put even curmudgeons at ease. He'd served a stint in Afghanistan and was left with a limp, and invisible wounds he never talked about, at least not to me. Like all of us here, he was building a new life, working hard, and in his case, attending the local community college, trying hard to earn a degree.
"Do you all know who that old guy is?"
he said, placing the coffee down next to his laptop and nodding toward Tanya's door.
"He's been around for a while. His name is Casey Osborne, one of the richest men in town. In all Essex County, for that matter. I saw him drive up in his black Cadillac while I was standing in line at Starbucks."
"He doesn't look that old to me,"
Vinton said defensively. I silently agreed. The man was roughly my age if you added a few years.
"But I do agree that Cadillacs age you. They went out with Minx."
"I hope Tanya's being careful."
Harley picked up his coffee again, took another sip.
"She said something to me last week about finding a new business partner and making some new investments. Hope it's not with that guy.
He's not in the mob, is he?
Genuine concern crossed Vinton's face.
No, he's too smart for that. But the young one, the guy who's with him, I don't know much about him, except his name. Tyler Chase. I've seen him hanging with guys you don't want to cross. The kind of dudes who would sooner cut your throat than say hello. He's a hustler. Been a hustler since he got out of high school, and I do know a hustler when I see one. I've seen enough of them in my day.
Yeah, like in the mirror,
Vinton said teasingly, which made Harley scowl, but then chuckle good-naturedly.
You're right about that, old man. Been there, seen that. You'd think Tanya would have learned to watch her money around men who mean her no good. She should know better by now. We all should have learned that lesson,
he said, more to himself than to any of us. Vinton shook his head and gave a somber sigh. Luella closed her eyes as if blocking disturbing thoughts. I kept mine to myself. Lively laughter and loud talking poured from Tanya's office, filling our small space with boisterous sound, bringing my Aunt Phoenix's words to mind. Just plain piggish. That was what she called big men who took up more food, drink, or space on buses and in life than they were entitled to. And these guys with their noisy presence and boisterous laughter struck me as just that. I didn't know who they were, but there was something not quite trustworthy about them. Or maybe it was simply Daryl's words coming back to me as they had. Yet, with the exception of Luella, Harley knew Tanya longer and better than any of us. Maybe he knew more than he was saying. I'm still not sure what to make of Tanya Risco, who had certainly changed in the year I'd known her. She'd inherited not only Risco Realty from Charlie Risco, her horror of a husband, but also his ill-gotten property and shady investments that made her a very wealthy woman, quite different from the battered young soul I'd first met. She was a good-looking girl, tall, thin, stylish, with an obsession for rich ladies' clothes that cost a working woman's weekly salary. Her skin was a tawny brown, darker or lighter depending on the time she spent in the sun. She slipped with ease into any world she deemed fashionable, be it white, black, or brown, to bask in the glory of being young and rich in a town where most folks were neither.
Us widows need to stick together,
Tanya had said to me the day after her husband's death, which knocked the stuffing out of me and took me a full minute to catch my breath. Yet, Tanya was also capable of generosity, paying for the funeral of a coworker who had taken her own life. When we'd met, Tanya had seemed a dreamy girl child, saddled with an abusive husband and low self-esteem. I was glad to see she was coming into her own, but I wasn't quite sure what that own meant, so I stirred her carefully with a long-handled spoon, as Aunt Phoenix would put it, well enough to mix but not get burned. The girl had no glimmer, as far as I could tell, which, according to my aunt, didn't necessarily mean that something was missing. But two men whom she'd been intimately involved with had met sudden, violent ends. Some folks might simply call that bad luck. I hoped that was all it was. I thought of that now as she left her office chatting and chuckling with the older of the two men. Luella dropped her head low and stared at her hands as they approached. Vinton impishly whistled the Imperial March from The Empire Strikes Back. Harley, cool as ever, leaned back in his chair, sipping his coffee. I forced my lips into an uncomfortable smile.
Casey, this is the lady I was telling you about. Here she is, working hard right in my little office. Can you imagine that? Well, anyway, this is Mrs. Dessa Jones, and she is a chef and the owner of D&D Delights. And I know she would love to cater your classy brunch for you next Sunday. She'll be doing me a big personal favor, won't you, Dessa?
Tanya's voice, sweet and chirpy, made me fear the worst. She grabbed a chair, pulling it into my cubicle so the man could sit down.
Casey told me he thinks he knew you from high school, that you knew his wife, so I guess you all go back. Listen, I'm going to leave you to talk business. Thanks, Case. Thanks, my dear Mrs. Jones, and don't let him shortchange you, she added with a wink.
Tanya had added the Mrs. Jones bit in the little girl voice she pulled out whenever she needed my favor or support. Apparently, she needed both. The wink said that the man had money, a not-so-subtle reminder that I hadn't had a sale in 2 months. It also said she was offering me a chance to fix my broken water heater, and I'd better not blow it.
Glad to be of service, Mr. Osborne, I said. Despite the warmer weather, I couldn't forget those cold showers. I'd complained so often that Vinton had finally offered me his, and I'd taken him up on it yesterday morning. Casey Osborne raised his eyebrows slightly and studied me like a bird contemplating a wriggling caterpillar.
It's too damn tight in here, he said, shifting his weight around in my small space to show how uncomfortable he was. These damn cramps are about to kill me, even with all those meds I keep getting. Don't do nothing but make me want to sleep. He paused for a moment to yawn loudly. You really don't remember me, do you? I looked harder, noticing again his pale, sweaty face, and I tried to imagine him younger and 30 pounds thinner. He had an odd smell about him, too, and I wondered if the gift was trying to tell me something.
Well, I know Tanya said that I knew your wife, but...
He threw back his head and laughed, louder than he needed to, as if I'd said something funny.
Wow, you really don't recognize me, do you? You don't remember the kids in high school shouting my name from the stands during those games? They called me Case then. Like, stay on the case, Case. Stay on the case.
He kept repeating the phrase as if that would jar my memory.
Oh, yes, I said, studying him again as everything about those miserable years came back in a rush. The high school I hated. The kids who hated me. And Case, the king of the place, who had just squeezed his hulking frame into my tiny cubicle.
I knew your wife, Aurelia, I added, remembering her part in my unpleasant history.
Ex-wife. Shook off that mean, crazy witch as soon as I could, he quickly corrected me. My new wife is Mona. Pretty name, pretty girl. You wouldn't have known her. She's younger than the two of you, he added unnecessarily. I nodded absent-mindedly, but my mind had gone back to Aurelia. The first one, a few years older than me, who had been my only friend and had never been crazy or evil, as far as I could remember. I spent a year and a half at Grovesville High. My father was between jobs, and my mother worked as a librarian in a nearby town. We stayed with Aunt Phoenix until we could find an apartment. She'd just bought her tiny house and filled it with hanging herbs and other plants that made my father sneeze and my mother's eyes water, which made her look like she was always weeping. I'm not sure if it was the high school, my mother's tears, or being a moody teenager that made my life so unbearable. I suspect Aunt Phoenix, with her eccentric ways, didn't help. And that was what endeared me to Aurelia, who was also saddled with an offbeat,
to put it kindly, aunt, who had recently moved to Grovesville from the Dominican Republic. Aunt Dahina would pick Aurelia up after cheerleading practice with the haughty airs of a 1930s movie star in her ancient, fume-spewing Oldsmobile that smelled up the road. Aurelia must have recognized a kindred suffering spirit in me and took me under her wing. No small thing for a senior to do for a freshman, particularly since Case Osborne was her boyfriend. I didn't like him. I knew that the moment I met him. I never understood what Aurelia saw in him, but it must have been something big because they stayed together after high school and eventually married. So, how is Aurelia these days? I asked because I honestly wanted to know. He answered with a shrug.
See as little of her as possible. Been divorced for years. I'm working on getting full custody of my son as soon as possible.
I studied him closely when he said that, thankful she was no longer with him, but also realizing that nothing about him had changed. Even his glimmer was the same as it had been in high school, although at the time I didn't know what it was because nobody bothered to explain. My mother avoided mentioning our gift, and Aunt Phoenix kept her knowledge to herself. Casey Osborne's glimmer was a bluish brown, a disconcerting shadow that made me instinctively pull away from him, just as I used to. Except now I knew what it was. He had been a nasty teenager, full of so much arrogance it left no room for anything else, including Aurelia, who worshipped him like a god. And she wasn't the only one. Casey Osborne ran the school. His prowess on the football field made up for his cruelty to other students. He collected young girls' hearts like football trophies, lying and cheating to get his way. His callous indifference drove one poor teenage girl to suicide. Or so it was said. Her death dimmed his star for a week, but nobody held him responsible, and after the initial mourning period was over, the girl was quickly forgotten. It seemed to make no difference to Aurelia at all, which I never understood. It certainly did to me, and that must have shown on my face.
"I see you remember me," he said, grinning wildly, misinterpreting my expression. So I went from high school, big-time scholarship to college, into business where, I guess folks would say, I made some killings, he added, answering a question I hadn't asked.
No doubt. He gave me a crooked, curious smile, then moved on.
So, the wife, Mona, we'll be calling you with details about the brunch, okay?
I said nothing for a beat, then remembered the chill of this morning's cold shower. Okay.
One thing the wife will probably forget to tell you, though, is about my son. She's beautiful, but forgetful. Lacey is seriously allergic to nuts. Walnuts, peanuts, nuts, period. He will definitely be there. So don't fix anything with nuts. Nothing. Here, this is a picture of him, so you'll know him when you see him.
He pulled up a picture of a teenage boy on his cell and thrust it in front of me.
He's my boy, though he doesn't look nothing like his dad. She, the witch, will come with him, so they'll be there together.
He does look like Aurelia. He has her pretty eyes, I said, remarking on what I could see of them. The boy looked half asleep, as if awakened for a photograph he didn't want to take. Osborne shrugged as if he'd never noticed. Aurelia's eyes or not, Lacey was no heartbreaker like his father had once been. The boy's face was scarred by adolescent acne, and his t-shirt fell sloppily off his large frame. His fake smile revealed a mouth filled with braces that had probably cost his father a fortune.
What he lacks in looks, he makes up in brains,
The wife is pregnant. A boy, they tell me.
He said with a proud grin, as if expecting me to congratulate him because the new one's looks would outshine those of the other.
By the way, there will be a lot of important folks there on Sunday, and if Mrs. Risco is right about you, more work should come your way. The wife will take care of the contract and whatever else you need.
He didn't offer a handshake, and I was grateful he didn't, but tossed two embossed, cream-colored business cards on my desk instead. Without saying anything else, he scraped his chair loudly on the floor as he pushed it out of my cubicle and headed back to Tanya's office.
Watch yourself, sunshine, Vinton muttered when Osborne was out of earshot.
Tanya's the one who better watch herself, Harley added, slurping the last of his coffee.
Luella, turning back to her computer, said nothing. The smell of nutmeg left me frozen in my chair. Chapter 2. I should have seen it coming. The signs were certainly there. The sudden whiff of nutmeg when Osborne left my cubicle. Daryl's voice coming in the morning as it did. The gift was whispering that death was headed my way, and I simply didn't hear it. Maybe I was still recovering from that morning shower that left me so cold I couldn't pee, or Osborne squeezing his bulk into my tiny space, or the wife's snooty directions for a classy brunch, whatever the heck that was. There just hadn't been enough space in my overworked brain for the gift's cryptic messages, so I was caught with my drawers down, as Aunt Phoenix would bluntly put it. My conversation with Mrs. Osborne began on an unfortunate note. Don't expect suggestions from me. I'm not some ignorant cook, she said when she called me after her husband left. Good thing she couldn't see my eyes roll to the back of my head. The conversation slid downhill from there. Any guests with seafood allergies? I asked.
Don't know. Just label everything so we won't be sued. And no meat, she said.
Go light on salt. I mostly drink smoothies, so I won't gain weight and try to always eat healthy. I won't be eating.
No mention of her stepson's nut allergy. That man knew his wife.
I expect you to take care of everything else. I will show up late in my pretty little dress with my pretty little smile.
Good thing she couldn't see my lips do a lemon-sucking pucker.
How many guests are you expecting?
30.
Our house is very large. The living room, vast. I'll email you a photograph of the space so you'll know what to expect.
So much for modesty.
What time is the event?
4:00,
I thought irritably. Too late for a brunch.
The rentals will be delivered Saturday, which is when I'll set things up, I said.
I'll need to come early on Sunday morning to do last-minute warm-ups, arrange platters, and...
Just don't wake me up, she broke in, cutting me off.
So I'll need to rent tables, tablecloths, chairs, dishes, platters, silverware, napkins... Glasses?
Rent whatever you need to rent, but bring things in through the back door in the kitchen. I don't want to see anybody. We'll take care of the liquor, bar, and bartender.
This is such short notice, and with all the rentals and everything, I'll need to charge you $100 a head, I said, my voice veering close to a whine.
I don't give a damn. I don't care about the money. Make it 150 for all I care. This is his thing, not mine. He gave you his card. Fax him the contract. Use it.
Done at $150 for 30 guests, I said, and hung up before she could change her mind. Then I leaned back in my chair, thanking the universe and those hovering spirits who mean me well. Wrote an agreement,
signed it, and faxed it to Osborne. That was when my nosy coworkers threw in their 2 cents worth.
$150 each for 30 people? Sunshine, you've come a long way from free chocolate chip cookies. You are kicking behind with your catering self. How much money are you going to make?
Asked Vinton, rubbing his palms together.
$4,500. You'll have it made in the shade, girl, as one of my old-timey boyfriends used to say. Do they need a bartender? Please tell me they do, and I'll be there with my starched white shirt and fawning grin. You know, I make a mean martini.
That's a lot of cooking, Dessa. A lot of serving. You need to get a lot of stuff done before Sunday. How will you handle all that?
Asked Harley. Thanks for the vote of confidence.
No, I mean it. You're going to need some serious help, he added, his voice filled with concern. He was right. I was struck dumb. The reality of what I'd just done suddenly smacked me in the face. I scrolled nervously through the photographs of a million-dollar house filled with million-dollar stuff. No doubt they were expecting a million-dollar brunch that was worthy of the house. Classy, as the woman had said. And now I knew what she meant. And that was not D&D delights. Not at this point, anyway. The walls of the vast living room were hung with abstract paintings of things I couldn't identify that I suspected cost more money than I wanted to know. Angular, modern sculptures that looked like they belonged on the moon were placed strategically throughout the room. An elegant staircase, obviously meant for floating down, snaked its way from the upper floors to the French doors leading into the living room. Sunlight poured in through the many picture windows. I could only imagine what the kitchen looked like. It would take big-time planning to pull off an event in a place like this. I hadn't tackled anything this fancy since Daryl left me. The most I'd done were cakes, cookies, and pies. Easy stuff. Daryl and I had been a team, and the event itself was almost an afterthought, except for the money, of course. He did the planning, figuring out how to use the space, writing the contracts, finding the rentals, dealing with setup and cleanup crews, and I had all the fun, planning, cooking, tasting. Daryl did some of that, too. We'd done a dinner for 45 a few months before he died, and pulled it off in high style. From soup to nuts in our case, black-eyed pea soup to peach cobbler, all of it had gone like clockwork, as well choreographed as an Alvin Ailey dance performance. Now, everything had changed. You okay, Dess?
Asked Harley, peering into my cubicle. Overwhelmed. I uttered the only word that captured how I felt. Harley dragged a chair into my cubicle to sit beside me.
Not depressed? Scared? Angry? Just overwhelmed?
I nodded like a woeful child.
Overwhelmed is easy. I can fix that.
How?
Listen, I'm up to doing anything you need me to. Cook, carry, serve. Name it. I owe you, big time.
I nodded, grateful, but could no more imagine Harley Wilde donning an apron than I could envision him in tights and a tutu. This was my business. I was on my own. If I was going to keep D&D Delights going, I had to find a way to do all the things a professional caterer was expected to do.
I'll be fine, I said, giving what I hoped was a confident smile. I picked up a pen and began scribbling down what I needed to do. Rentals, menu, cooking, pre-event setup, plating, serving, post-event cleanup. I stopped, abruptly laying my pen back down on my desk. Was I delusional? Why did I sign that contract? had that cold shower I took this morning frozen my brain. How could I do this by myself? To myself. D&D Delights was not what we'd planned it to be. I needed Daryl for that. What kind of a fool was I? I should call Osborne immediately and tell him I had to cancel. Plead with him. Convince him that I'd made a mistake. A close relative had just had a heart attack. I'd come down with a disgusting stomach flu. My catering license had just been suspended. Anything to get out of it. What the heck was I trying to prove? Who the heck was I trying to prove it to? I picked up my cell, ready to call, when a text came in from, why was I not surprised? Aunt Phoenix. My aunt texts rather than talk, and usually sends me her numbers for the Jersey Pick Four, which I always forget to play, and she always wins. But sometimes she sends quotes from Maya Angelou, or random folks she happens to like, or African proverbs, always followed by an emoji flower. It was Maya this time. You alone are enough. You have nothing to prove to anybody. My aunt and Dr. Angelou got it right. I was enough. I had nothing to prove to anybody. All I could do was the best I could do. Thank you, Aunt Phoenix, I texted back. Just do it, was her quick response, followed by a meme of Colin Kaepernick and another emoji flower. Harley watched me with interest. Aunt Phoenix, I said. He nodded as if he understood. He'd met my aunts, Phoenix and Celestine, over the summer. Their fascination with each other was mutual.
If he were 20 years older, he might be a good marriage prospect for you, Celestine observed.
Phoenix, who disliked the very concept of marriage, had answered her suggestion with a loud Bronx cheer. I was never sure what Aunt Phoenix's reasons were for distrusting the institution, and I'd never had the nerve to ask. Just thinking about my two aunts, though, made me smile, which was obviously contagious. Harley smiled, too, but then he turned serious. Listen, I can pick up anything you need. Carry it wherever you want me to take it. Set things up, take things down, do the heavy lifting. I've got an appointment now, but let me know tonight, okay? He strapped on his motorcycle helmet, giving me a reassuring pat on my shoulder.
I don't know. Harley, I...
Promise. I nodded that I would. Luella, quietly listening, made her offer after he'd gone.
I owe you too, Dessa. I can help you cook if you tell me what to do. Set everything up if I know where to put it. Anything you want.
You know who this brunch is for, don't you? I said, recalling her reaction to Osborne.
Yeah, but we need the money, me and Red. I want Erica to go to camp later this summer, and he's doing some odd jobs. Working for a landscaper, helping stack bags in a garden store, stuff like that. But nothing pays good. I don't need to tell Red everything I do, and I sure won't tell him about this. I'm probably overreacting anyway, she added, as if reminding herself of her independence. And remember, you promised to show me how to cook. I'm sick of McDonald's and Kentucky Fried Chicken. I want to feed everybody healthy stuff. This would be a chance for me to learn. All I can do right is fry bacon and scramble eggs. I suspected she was right about the bacon and eggs, and I had promised to teach her how to cook. I was also glad to hear that she wanted to become more independent. From what I'd heard, Red was overly protective of both Luella and their daughter. She'd also mentioned once that he had a temper. She didn't give any details, but it still made me uncomfortable. Red didn't sound like a bad guy, and I wondered how long the two of them would be together, but kept my thoughts to myself. She was still young, and it was important for her to strike out on her own as much as she could,
even if it was just to prove to herself she could do it. Down the line, she might be able to help me with some catering jobs later on. It just might work. Ordinarily, I'd need two assistants for a party like this, but it was too late to hire anyone. Luella and Harley might be a good fit. Harley could do the heavy work, like he said, and Luella could help with the cooking and serving. She was a quick study, eager to learn new things, and it would be an opportunity to show her some kitchen basics. Now would be as good a time as any. Well? Luella reminded me her question was hanging in the air. It's going to be a very busy 2 days. Will you have the time? With Erica? I promise I won't let you down, she said, with such determination that I knew she was good for her word. I studied the photos of the living room, visualizing how I could make the space work for 30 guests and 2 assistants. I'd place 2 long buffet tables against the wall to hold the small luncheon plates. 5 round tables with chairs that could seat 6 would be set with silverware, glassware, napkins, and an understated centerpiece. Everything would be brought and arranged the night before, like I'd told Mrs. Osborne, and I'd be there early enough on Sunday morning to do what I needed to do. The food, no nuts, no meat, needed to be dishes easy to prepare the night before and serve with minimal prep and arrangement in the morning. I'd need to do a menu I could make with my eyes closed. Quiches, collard green, broccoli and cheese, mushroom, leek tart, muffins, assorted jams, salmon croquettes, baked, not fried, small veggie platter, and sugar cookies for dessert, along with coffee and assorted teas. It would be hard work, but suddenly I knew I could pull it off. Thanks to Maya Angelou, Colin Kaepernick, and Aunt Phoenix. I called the party rental place we always used and was touched by their fond memories of D&D Delights and Daryl. They were glad to know we were back in business and eager to do what they could to help. My small kitchen was soon stuffed with everything I needed to cook. My only concern was Juniper, who curiously, hungrily, longingly surveyed everything within his sight. The rental deliveries came on Saturday, and Harley was at the Osborne's place, ready to bring them into the house through the back door and set everything up. When Luella stepped into my kitchen, she stopped short, maybe remembering the last time she'd come here. It was before the heartbreaking situation with her mother, and the night she'd shared the history that still haunted her. We sat for a while, Luella admiring again my kitchen, which is painted celestial blue and trimmed in white. I feel like I'm in heaven, she said, and I smiled despite myself because I often felt the same way. I made a pot of rooibos tea to boost our energy, and we talked a while about the past year, but not for long. We had work to do, and we both knew it. We were up past midnight cooking, prepping, plating, packing everything that needed to be cooked, prepped, plated, and packed. We each toasted a job well done with a glass of Merlot when the clock struck 1. I baked 2 extra collard green quiches for myself and stuck them in the freezer for later use. You never know when you might need an extra quiche. At the last minute, I realized I'd forgotten the assorted jams for the muffins, then remembered the peach preserves Aunt Phoenix had canned over the summer. They would be a tasty, colorful addition to the marmalade and strawberry jam that happened to be in my fridge. Luella and I were at the Osborne house early Sunday morning, ready to roll. Shortly before the first guest arrived, Casey Osborne strolled in from a closed room off the kitchen, sipping what could have been bourbon, which he quickly gulped down. He filled a fancy-looking blender with almond milk, strawberries, and blueberries, then opened a large glass jar filled with what looked like seeds. He took a sniff,
wrinkled his nose like a kid does when he smells something nasty, screwed it closed, and put it back on the counter. He blended the fruit mixture, poured it into two large glasses, and gulped one down. Slicing a piece of quiche, he tasted it, sprinkled it with about a teaspoon of salt, then ordered us to add more to what was left on the platter. I nodded.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.